All right. So let us continue. And let me show you guys this the paradigm of the masculine noun endings again. Okay. So a regular masculine word won't let you know in the singular form if it's masculine or feminine. No, there's no particular ending that gives us a clue. Okay. And so for this particular word, sus, and I think what I'll do is also I'll give you the handwriting form of this word as well. Okay. So I'm gonna do that right now. And I feel purple today. So I'm gonna write it in purple. So give me one second. Okay. So for sus, the word sus, the way that we spell it is Asamic, Shorek, and Samic. Okay. And so in the handwriting form, this is what it looks like. Okay. So Samic, a Shorek, and then a Samic. All right. And then the way that we read it is sus, sus. Okay. For the plural, again, let me write it. Okay, for the plural, all I need to do is add a hirik yod at the end. So hirik yod. Okay, and then finally, a final form mem. Okay, so for the plural, it is a hirik yod with the final form mem. And the way that you pronounce this word is susim, susim. Okay, susim. All right, and as I told you last week, the dual is a very unique form within Hebrew. Greek does not have a dual form, but it is specifically two of something. So for this example, sus means horse, okay? So the plural form susim, the way that you will translate it in English is horses, horses, okay? And for the plural, or for the dual, I should say, it is susayim. That's how you read it, susayim, okay? And susayim means specifically two horses, okay? And so let me write that down for you guys right now. So that's horrible. So just ignore that. I'm going to scratch that because that doesn't look pretty. So, Samik, Shrek, Samik. Okay. And in this case, I add a patak in the final consonant. Okay. And then I add a yod. And below the yod, I add the hirek. And then finally, the final form mem. Okay? And so the way that we pronounce this word is susayim, susayim. Okay? So the common masculine forms will follow these patterns. Okay? So all you need to do for the plural form is add the hirik yod mem to it, okay? And then finally, the dual is the patak yod hirik mem, okay? So that iam sound. All right? So again, in the singular, it is just a horse, plural, horses, and dual, two horses. Any questions about that? Okay, so then let me continue on Let me continue on with the feminine noun endings or the feminine nouns, okay? So let me erase the markings. And let's go to the feminine chart, all right? For the singular, the example that I'm going to use is Torah, Torah. And this is how you spell it. You have a tav, okay? And I'm going to add a dagesh lehne in the tav, okay? Then I go with the vav, okay? And a dot above it. This is the vowel, the cholam vav, okay? Then I do a resh, okay? Now I'm going to stop right here for a moment, and I want to give you guys time to actually write it out if you're writing it out. Okay? So tav, cholam vav, resh. Okay? So we've done the three letters here at this present moment. Okay? Now this isn't going to happen all the time. Majority of the time, it's going to happen for feminine words, but you see this patache at the end of it? What I just circled or squared right now? That patache lets us know that this is a feminine word. Okay? So this is a clue in the Hebrew language to let us know that this word is a feminine word. So majority of the time, and I'm going to say majority of the time because unfortunately there are exceptions, but majority of the time, when you have a patache at the end of a word, that lets you know that that is a feminine singular word, okay? Especially if it's a noun, okay? We probably won't go into too much into verbs, okay? But there are verb forms that do look like that. That's different. That's different. These are specifically for nouns, all right? And so whenever you see this patache at the end of a word, it gives us a clue that it is a feminine word, okay? All right, cool. That kind of adds some complications when we add the plural and dual sometimes, okay? Here's why, all right? When we go into the plural, oh, and by the way, Torah, if you guys aren't sure of what Torah means law. Torah means law, okay? Another, and in my opinion, better translation of this word Torah is instruction, okay? So it could mean law or instruction, okay? But it means that's where we get the first five books of Moses, the Torah, this is law, okay? So when it's singular, it is law or instruction, okay? Now, check this out. For the plural, before we add the ending, which is this, okay, we have to drop the patache. Okay? You gotta take this out, the patache. All right? And you're just left with the first part, those three letters, all right? And then you add the ending. So the way that we spelled it, again, tav with a dagesh. Lene in it, a vav, okay, a resh, okay. For the plural feminine ending, we got to add a cholam vav tav. So, okay, and that is the Hebrew feminine plural ending. That cholam vav tav. That here, okay? However, before you add that, you got to take the kamets hey off the feminine word, okay? And then you are left with the plural form of this word. And the way that we read this plural form, you guys, is toroth. Toroth. Okay? So toroth, when translated, if it's the plural form, means what? It means instructions, instructions, or laws. Okay? So, toroth. Okay? All right. Now let's go into the dual form, the feminine dual form. All right? One more time. I'm just going to write those first three letters. So again, Tav, the Cholam Vav, okay, and the Resh. All right. Now, the dual ending for the feminine is so. This is what the dual ending is. Okay? So it's the Tav, Patach, Yod, Hiret, Mem. Okay? That's what it is. That's what the dual ending is. And I'll write that after. However, what I want to let you guys know, before you add that ending onto the word, the feminine word, you got to take just the hey out. Okay? The patach remains there. If it's there, the patach remains there. Or whatever the vowel is there, it remains there. Okay? You just got to take away that hey at the end of the word. Okay? And so once we do that, then we can add the dual ending. All right? And that's what I'll be doing right now. Okay? So I add a tav. And then underneath the tav, I add a patach. Then I add the yod. And underneath the yod, I add a hirek. And then finally, final form, mem. Okay? And the way that we read this word, or the way that we pronounce this word, is torathayim. Torathayim. One more time. Torathayim. Torathayim. Okay? And so the translation of torathayim is two instructions, or two laws specifically. All right? Questions about that? And I do see a hand up, and I apologize if that hand was up for a long time. But, and I have a couple, so I apologize for that. Go ahead, Leanne.
So, is IM, or like the yod and the final form mem, and the hirek under the yod, is that going to be constant for the dual ending for both feminine and masculine?
Yes, it is going to be, it will be constant. However, for the feminine, what's different compared to the masculine is it has a tav above the patach. In the masculine, we don't have that, okay? So that tav is specific for the feminine dual ending.
Okay.
But that will be constant. Okay? And Patricia, yes, I have your hand up as well. Go ahead.
How do you pronounce the plural again?
The plural is toroth. Toroth.
Like with the F sound or a TH sound?
TH sound. Okay. You're welcome. And then Brianna, you have your hand up as well.
Sir, can you explain again why in the dual form you take out the hey in the first part of it? Can you explain that again?
Well, I don't know the actual reason the Hebrew people did it, but they just for some reason they felt that they just needed to take out that final hey. So
can I ask, in the future, in any of our worksheets, will we have to know to figure out to take out something like that?
I'm sorry, say that again.
I said, so in any future worksheet or anything, will we have like a problem like that where we'll have to figure out to take out something?
Yes.
Like the hay?
Yes, yes. Okay. You will definitely need to know that for the feminine. So, okay. All right. So I noticed Michael is on the list, and I think I have him muted. So I am unmuting you now, Michael. But yes, okay, so then let's continue on. So those are masculine nouns and how they work and what you need to add for the plural and the masculine. Then we have feminine, okay? And so let me show you some exceptions. Let me show you some exceptions now, okay? Because whether we like it or not, there's always exceptions to languages, okay? So let me just erase this. All right, so Hebrew noun exceptions. Okay, the first one that I want to let you guys know of is the endingless feminine nouns. Remember how I told you that a good clue of certain feminine nouns is that comet's hay at the end of a word? Unfortunately, it doesn't work all the time. It's not there all the time. And we have certain words here in particular that are feminine. They are considered feminine words, okay? But they don't have that comet's hay ending, all right? But honestly, well, let me share a couple of things. If, like, say you get tested on these things, I'll let you know if it's a masculine or feminine word, okay? I'll let you know if it's a masculine or feminine word, all right? Especially with these exceptions, all right? But the other thing, too, is to keep in mind, these are actually a lot easier if you think about it, okay? You don't really have to remember taking away the hay or taking away the comet's hay. All you need to do is just add the endings to these words. That's all you need to do, okay? And so, for example, let me just write it out here. The first word here, I'm circling right now, and purple is not a really good color for this brown. So I'm going to get something that pops. Let's see. I think I'm going to use yellow. Yellow's a good one, okay? So that first word, the way that we pronounce the first word is edits, edits, okay? Edits, all right? And so this is a feminine noun. This is a feminine noun, but it doesn't have the ending to it, all right? And the next thing that I'm going to do for you guys is I'm going to write out, write it in the handwriting form, okay? So the first consonant is an aleph, okay? And underneath it is a segol or segol. That is a dot. I assure you that's a dot and not something else. And the next one is the consonant resh. Okay. And then under resh, we have another segol. Okay. And then the final consonant is a final form tsade, okay? It is a final form tsade, all right? And so that is what I'm going to write down here, okay? So what we have here is the word edits, edits. And if you guys want to know what edits means land, land, L-A-N-D, okay? And I'll write that down in your I'll write that down in your chat box, okay? So edits means land, all right? Now say a Hebrew teacher wanted me to pluralize this word, wanted me to pluralize this word. What I need to do is I need to add an ending, okay? And the cool thing about these endingless feminine nouns, I don't need to take anything away. I don't have to take anything away before I add the ending. And one more time, what is the ending? The ending is the holam vav and the tav, right? Okay? The holam vav and the tav. All right. So what this will look like is with the ending is follows. Okay. So we have edits. Okay. Now I'm not going to put the final form here, right? Because it's not a final form anymore when I add this ending. Okay, so I have to make the middle form of tsade, which I'm doing right now, okay? And then I add the ending, okay? That's a tav, by the way. I'm going to get carpal tunnel once I'm done here, but that is a tav. I assure you that's a tav. Okay. So that's how you apply the ending for these endingless feminine nouns. Like I said, I think that's what makes them easier, than knowing or trying to remember that you got to take something out. All you need to do is just attach the ending to it. And so the way that we read this word is Eretzoth, Eretzoth, okay? Which means lands, lands, okay? So Eretzoth. So that's how you pluralize these endingless feminine nouns. Any questions about that? Yes, I think I see your hand. Do you have a question, Josh? No? Okay. All right. Sorry. All right. Okay, cool. So then let me continue on with some other Hebrew noun exceptions. All right. I'm going to erase everything that I wrote here because it will get in the way. So, but another Hebrew noun exception is the exception to normal pluralization. Okay. The exception to normal pluralization. What do I mean by that? Okay. Sometimes masculine nouns will take feminine plural endings and vice versa. Okay. Sometimes masculine plural nouns will take feminine plural, excuse me, masculine singular nouns will take feminine plural endings to make them plural. Okay. Again, I don't think I'm going to test you guys on that. Just for your own knowledge of how Hebrew words behave, I wanted to let you guys know that because it is more common than not. All right. One very common example is the word of. Okay. And of means father. This is Avraham or Abraham. It's the father of many nations, right? Av is father. Okay. And so in the singular form, it is Aleph. Okay, and then the comets, and then the bait. Okay, now we know just by deductive reasoning what gender of is. If it means father, most likely than not, it's what? It's a masculine word, and you'll be right. Okay, if you guess that, if you think that, it is a masculine word. It is a masculine word, okay? And so the assumption would be to add a masculine plural ending to this word, right? And that is a correct assumption. That is a logical assumption. But for the exception, it's wrong. It'll be wrong, okay? It actually takes a feminine plural ending, okay? So instead of seeing the hirek yod mem, avim, okay, it's actually avot. So that's a holam vav and then a tav, okay? Avoth. I'm not sure why the Hebrews decided to make a masculine noun singular have a feminine plural ending. There must be a reason. I just don't have it, but that's the plural form of the word, okay? And so, like I said, if this ever comes up on a test, I'll let you know that this is an irregular verb or an irregular word, excuse me, and that you need to attach a feminine ending to it. But other than that, there's no other way of actually really knowing the differences and so forth. There's no pattern. There's no pattern why some words will have a masculine, will be masculine, but have a feminine plural ending. Okay? So that's another noun exception. Okay. May I continue on? Is there any questions? Or are there any questions, I should say? Yes, Santiago, go ahead, sir.
How do you pronounce that word, Professor?
Absolutely. So let me start off with the singular. This is av, like A-V, av, like in avocado, av, okay? And the plural is avoth, avoth, okay? Which means fathers, fathers. Okay? All right. I had actually let me see. Oh, and that's what's going to happen. So sorry. Thank you for your patience right there. Okay. So the next irregular that I want to mention or exception are irregular stem changes. Going back to Greek, there's a root word, there's a stem word, that part of the word that doesn't change. That part of the word that doesn't change, but when we actually study it, sometimes that stem or that root does change. That's the same thing with Hebrew. Sometimes when we pluralize words, when we pluralize them, the stem actually changes. The stem actually changes. One particular example is the word Isha, okay? Now, Isha is spelled as follows. It's a Aleph, Shin, He, okay? So I'm going to write that down for you. So I start off with an Aleph. I get a Hidek, okay? Then I'm going to do the Shin. Okay, and then add a comment underneath it. And then I'm going to add a dot here because they have a dot there as well. All right. All right. And then finally, I'm going to add the hey. Okay. Isha. Isha in Hebrew is woman. Okay. Isha in Hebrew is woman. Man is ish. Okay. So ish for man. Isha for woman, okay? And so the plural form of it, however, as you'll notice, is very different. And that's what I mean with the irregular stem change. What we have for the plural is it begins, instead of that aleph, it begins with a nun. Okay? It begins with a nun. Then I add the comments underneath it. Okay. Then I add the shin. A hirik yod. And then finally the mem. Okay. And so the way that you pronounce this word, you guys, is nashim. Nashim. Okay. And that in Hebrew is women. Women. Okay. So there's Isha for the singular and Nashim for the plural, okay? So that's what I mean with the irregular stem change, okay? Any questions about that? Yes, Leanne, go ahead.
So for the irregular stem changes, how did you know to change the aleph to a nun?
Through memorization and negative reinforcement from my teacher. there's no real pattern. I wish I could tell you guys that there's a pattern for these irregular stem changes, but they're not. And so basically what my Franciscan monk of a teacher told me, you better learn it or you'll fail the class. And so I don't want to be that vicious to you guys because, again, I'll let you know when there's these irregularities and so forth. But the unfortunate thing is it's just through rote memorization, just learning these things. I just wanted to show you that there are exceptions out there, and that's why Hebrew – that's another reason why Hebrew is a very difficult language for me to understand or to grasp.
So, I should say.
Yeah, go ahead.
Are we going to have regular stem changes
on the test? No, not frequently. If there is one, I will let you know of it. I will definitely let you know of it. Okay. All right, and then finally, the last exception that I want to talk about is basically there are words that are always dual. There are words that are always dual, okay? There's and I provide some examples of that here. Okay, so for example, let's do the first word. The first word is mayum, mayum, okay? And so the way that we write it is a mem with a patach underneath it, okay? Then the yod with a hirech underneath that, and then a final form mem. And so the way that we pronounce this word is mayum, mayum, okay? This doesn't mean two waters. It does not mean that. It means water. It's just, it's a dual form. It is a dual form, okay? So this is the exception, or this is the challenging part, all right? And so we have to understand that, and we have to realize that, that there's certain words that look dual, but they're not. And so if you ever see a word in your vocabulary list that looks dual, okay, it's not translated literally as a dual word like this, okay? It's translated as water. That's how we should understand it, not literally as two waters, okay? Another characteristic in Hebrew is that a lot of countries and a lot of cities are dual, okay? So for this one, the word for Egypt in the Old Testament is Mitzrayim, Mitzrayim. Okay, that dual sounding part at the end, it makes it dual. I mean, the word looks dual, and it is, but we don't translate it as two Egypts. We translate it simply as Egypt, because like I said, a lot of countries and cities are dual. The word Jerusalem in Hebrew, Jerusalem, or Yerushalayim, I should say. Yerushalayim, it's a dual ending at the end of it, but we don't call it two Jerusalems. We call it one. Or no, we don't call it one, but we just simply call it Jerusalem, okay? So countries and cities often are dual, but they're literally not translated as dual. And then finally, we have Shamayim, Shamayim. And let me write that out for you, Shamayim. So we have a shin. A comet's underneath the shin. Then we have a mem. Okay. A patach underneath the mem. The yod. A hirek underneath the yod. And then finally, a final form mem. Okay. And shamayim. Shamayim. Shamayim means heavens. It doesn't mean two heavens. It just simply means heavens. It just adopts, it just takes a dual ending for its word. Okay, and if you guys noticed the difference between water and heavens is just that shin in front of heavens, okay, Shamayim and Mayim. Remember, this is really cool. Remember, you know, what happened in the Noah story, right? The floodgates tore, and that's where the flood came from. So for the Hebrew people, they understood that the sky and the water, they believed that they had similar elements to each other, that they were similar because of that Noah story, right? And so that's why we have this very close similarity between the word water and heavens, okay? Any questions? All right. So then let's continue on. So that's basically it with the Hebrew nouns. I'm going to show you the basic characteristics of Hebrew nouns, showed you the basic characteristics of masculine nouns, and then as well as the feminine. All right. So then now let's get into the definite article, Okay. I have to erase all these. Okay. And so let us continue on with the definite article and the conjunction vav, okay? And I'll explain more what the conjunction vav is once we get there, okay? But we all know what a definite article is, right? In English, it is simply the word the, okay? It makes something indefinite definite. So I would say a horse, that's an indefinite word. And if I wanted to make it definite, apply the definite article in front of it, it is the horse, okay? Here's the thing about the definite article. It attaches itself in front of a word, okay? Think of it like a parasite. And in many ways, a lot of things in Hebrew act like parasites, okay? Act like leeches, if you will. And the definite article attaches itself in front of the word that it's defining or making definite, okay? So it's not a separate word in Hebrew. Unlike what we saw in Greek, where Greek, we had all these different cases, all these different forms, that is a separate word for the word the, right? In Hebrew, it attaches itself. It attaches itself, okay? So that being said, this is what the definite article looks like with a particular word, all right? So this is the definite article. And you might be saying, Professor, what do you mean? It's all Hebrew to me. And you're absolutely right. And so let me explain it to you guys, okay? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to circle for you guys the definite article, all right? And just brace yourself. Okay, that is the definite article, all right? It is a hey with a patach and a dagesh, okay? So let me actually write that down in the handwriting. Let me first start off with the word. I'm going to write the word first that it's placing the definite article on. We'll start off with a mem, okay? And then underneath the mem, we got a segol. Then we got the lamed, my favorite consonant in the Hebrew letters, in the Hebrew alphabet. And underneath our lamed, we have a segol. Okay. And then this little doohickey here is a final kaf form. A final kaf form. And the way that we write it out is as so. Okay. And then in the final kaf, we have a silent schwa, okay? So that is the word that we are making definite. We are making definite, okay? And the way that we pronounce this word is melech, melech, okay? Melech means king, okay? Melech means king, okay? And this is actually a very common word in the ancient in the Middle East, that those consonants are. For example, the Arabic form of this word is Malik, Malik, okay? So the consonants have been preserved. This suggests that this was a very powerful word and a very common word throughout the entire ancient Near East during the time of the Israelites. It wasn't simply the Israelites' word. It was also the Mesopotamians. It was also the Babylonians. It was also the Assyrians and so forth. It's a very powerful and common and strong word, okay? And so this is the Hebrew form of it, melech, melech, which again means king, okay? Now, the definite article, and I'm going to make it hot pink, okay, this is what the definite article looks like. Again, you attach it to the word. You attach it to the word, okay? So what I need to do to make it definite is I add a hey in front of it. Hey, okay? Then underneath the hey is a patach. And then this dot, this dagesh, is also part of the definite article. That's the kicker here. That's the kicker here, okay? I had a bad habit in forgetting that dagesh. And it took a long, long time to fix that habit for me. So based on my personal gripe and experience and heartache, I wanted to emphasize it to you guys. You need that dagesh there, okay? You need that dagesh there. That is connected, or that is part of the definite article, okay? So when we read it as so. Ha melech. Ha melech. Okay? This means the king. The king. Okay? Questions about that? And I do see hands up. I apologize for if you guys had your hand up for a while. Go ahead, Leanne.
Professor, so the dagesh, do we just follow the rules, and that differentiates the Dagesh Forte and the Dagesh Linne.
Right, right. And so in this case, because it's a definite article, it will supersede the rules, especially for the Bagat Kafat letters. This is a Dagesh Forte. This is a Dagesh Forte. No ifs, ands, or buts. Okay? So if you ever see a Dagesh in front of the word that's a Bagat Kafat letter, that becomes a Dagesh Forte. Okay? And I believe there was another question. And go ahead. I guess there wasn't. So my apologies for that. So again, that's the definite article. That's the basic definite article. And what I've done is I gave you the word version of it. And so yeah, it's a hey with a patak with the Dagesh Forte. And let me actually erase my chicken scratch. Okay. And let me actually write it somewhere else, okay? So I'm going to choose the same pen color. Okay, so that hey, patach, and Dagesh Forte, that is your definite article, and you're just hooking it on, if you will, or imagine this as a button, this Dagesh Forte, and so you're just buttoning it on the word, all right? And that's the biggest kind of, this is the biggest clue for the definite article. The definite article is always attached. It is always attached. It's never detached. It's never separated from the word, okay? It's always going to be connected with the word. And like I said, in Hebrew, there's a lot of things that you attach on words. A lot of things that you attach on words, okay? And that's one of those common characteristics in Hebrew. Okay, now, again, there are exceptions. There are exceptions, and they're no fun, but we have to understand these exceptions to correctly write out these Hebrew words, okay? So the first thing that I want to talk about is the definite article with initial guttural, an initial guttural, okay? So let me continue on. Okay, the article with the initial gutturals, because here's the reason why. Gutturals, remember, hate Dageshes. It doesn't matter if it's a Dagesh Forte, Dagesh Lene, Dagesh whatever. It hates taking Dageshes. It doesn't like Dageshes, okay? And we've come to realize that there's a lot of words. There are a lot of words in the Hebrew that begin with gutturals. A lot of them, okay? So what happens? What happens? Here's the rule. Here's the rule, okay? Well, let me actually write it out for you. So the example that I'm going to show you guys in the written form is specifically the word ish. Okay. And this is pink. I don't want pink. I want yellow. Okay. So the word ish, I'm going to write right now. I have the aleph. Okay. Then I'm going to add the Hirek Yod, okay? And then I'm going to add the Shin, okay? Ish. Again, what is Ish? I showed you the word Isha, which means woman. This is man, okay? Ish. Yes, go ahead.
I was just saying it's man.
Okay, right on. Very good. And so, with this example, you guys, aleph, we know, is a guttural word. It is a guttural word, all right? And so this word begins with a guttural. That's what I mean when I say initial guttural, okay? The initial guttural, all right? And like I said, the gutturals do not take a doggish forte. So how do we apply the article to this kind of word, okay? Here's the rule. Here's the rule, okay? When a word begins with an aleph, ayin, and resh, okay? When a word begins with an aleph, ayin, or resh, there's something that is known as compensatory lengthening that occurs, okay? Compensatory lengthening. I dare you to say that 5 times fast. Compensatory lengthening, okay? It's a fancy word for basically saying that whatever vowel that's underneath the hay, it will lengthen, okay? So that being said, the layman version of it is this. The patach under the hay lengthens to a comets, okay? And so the proper spelling for this word with the definite article is as follows. Oh no, I erased it. Let me do that again. Sorry. So I'm going to write ish again. And then I'm going to show you the proper way of attaching the definite article in front of this word. Okay? And so I'm going to make that pink. So I'm going to add the hey. Okay? Instead of a patak, as I showed you before in the default form of it, that patak becomes a comets. And that, my friends, is compensatory lengthening. Okay? So whenever you have an ayin or an aleph beginning a word, you don't give it the dagesh forte. Okay? Because again, gutturals hate dogishes, all right? And all you do is make the patach into a comets, all right? That is how you put the definite article in front of these kinds of words. Any questions about that? Okay, so in a grammar book, in a Hebrew grammar book, this is known as compensatory lengthening. Compensatory lengthening. All right? All right, I'm going to continue on. Got to erase this. All right, the next exception is the article with the other gutturals, okay? And those gutturals are chet and hey, okay? And the rule for chet and hey is instead of compensatory lengthening, something else occurs. It's known as virtual doubling. Virtual doubling, okay? What is virtual doubling? Virtual doubling is that the patak remains, but the dagesh forte is rejected, okay? Because like I said, gutturals hate dogeshes. They do not like dogeshes, okay? If you wish to repeat that after me, I want you to really get this idea solidified in your head. Gutturals hate dogeshes, okay? They don't like a dogesh in them, okay? They just think it's not cool, if you will, okay? So that being said, the example that I provide here is hey kol, hey kol, all right? Hey kol means tabernacle or tent. And so I'm going to write that down here for you guys right now. Okay, so hey kol, it starts with a hey. Okay? And then a patach underneath the hay. And then you have the yod. And then finally the kaf. And then underneath the kaf is a comets. And then finally the lamed. Hey call. I should have pronounced it. That should have been the pronunciation. I apologize for that. Heykal. And again, Heykal means tent. Heykal means tent. If I wanted to add a definite article in front of this word, okay, here's what I have to do. All I need to do All I need to do is add a hey, letting me know that's the definite article, and just simply a patach, okay? I don't need to add anything here. Why? They don't like the dagesh. They don't like the dagesh, okay? So, again, whenever you have the word chet or hey in front of a word that begins the word, which in this example, all you need to do is just add the hey and the patach. And that's ha hey kol. Ha hey kol. Okay? Questions about that? Go ahead, Joseph.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you now.
Can you flip back to that previous slide so I can take a shot?
Okay, I can go back to the previous slide.
Yeah, I was going to ask, are you recording this?
I am recording this, yes, sir. All right, so what I'll do is let me go back to the other slide. And I gotta erase this so that it won't get away in the other slide. Okay.
Thank you.
You're quite welcome. Anyone else want me to go to the next slide and just have them, if they're missing some information on that one? Okay. I'm going to continue on. And there's one final exception that I want to mention in regards to the definite article. And it has to do with irregular segal vowels. Irregular segal vowels, okay? And basically what this is this. You know, I'm not sure why they're called segal. I forgot for some reason why they're called segal. But if a word begins with these specific consonants, and specific vowels, okay? So if a word begins with a chet comet, okay? So what that looks like in handwriting form is as so, okay? A hey comet or an ayin comet, okay? So these specifically, if you see these specifically beginning a word, the definite article will have a segol instead of a patach, okay? It will have a segol instead of a patach. And so what we have here is the word hokam, hokam, okay? And if I remember off the top of my head, hokam, I think it means wisdom. No, it's wise person. It's wise person, okay? And so if I wanted to add a definite article in front of it, instead of the patach, you guys, I have to just add a segol, okay? And I'll just write that down underneath it. So let me write the consonant out first. All right, so it's a hey with the comets. a cough with the comments, and a final form mem. Final form mem. Okay? And if I want to make it definite, I'm going to add the hey in front of it. I'm going to change the color here. And that's not what I wanted to do, so I apologize for that. As a matter of fact, I'm going to move it right here because I think you can see the vowels better up here. All right. So in order for me to add the definite article and adding it properly according to the rules of Hebrew, what I need to do with that hey, that definite article hey, so this is the definite article, instead of the patach, I got to add a segel. Okay? And that's what it will look like properly with this specific word or these specific words, okay? So again, if it begins with a chet, if your word begins with a chet, comets, a hey, comets, or an ayin, comets, and that was a bit too long, I apologize for that, okay? If it begins with these three consonants with this particular vowel, this is the definite article, okay? Now, with these irregularities, what was a common factor? What was a common trait with all these irregularities? They all began with gutturals. They all began with gutturals, or they all began with consonants that do not want a dagesh within them. That was the problem. That was the problem. And so what the Hebrew writers did is they had to change things in order for that dagesh not to be there for those words, okay? So that's what's happening right now. That's what's going on right now. It's trying to figure out a way not to put the dagesh. And so what do? They change the vowel underneath the hey. They change the vowel underneath the hey, okay? Questions? Okay, so then we have about 12 minutes before we get into break. Why don't we do some practice? Let's do some practice and actually apply what we've learned today, okay? So the first thing that I'm going to do, or we're going to do some exercises on how to pluralize words, okay? So give me 1 second, and let me escape from this. Okay, and so, that's perfect. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you guys a word. All right? And then I'm going to tell you if it's masculine or feminine, okay? All I'm asking you guys to do is you guys let me know what ending I need to apply on these words, okay? So that's how we're going to do these exercises. If you think you have the answer, just raise your hand via webinar and I will call on you to let you know. Leanne, I'm only going to give you 3 chances, okay? So here we go, all right? So the first one I'm going to write is the following. It's a 3-consonant word, all right, or a 3-letter word. It starts off with a bait. And a dagesh within the bait, okay? Then I have the holim vav. So it's a vav with a dot above it, okay? And then finally, the resh, okay? And so the way that we pronounce this word, you guys, is bor, okay? Bor. Certain teachers are a bor, right? That's the way that you pronounce this word, bor. All right. And what bor is in Hebrew is the word pit. That's what it means in Hebrew, pit. Okay. This word is a feminine word. It is a feminine word. Okay. I want someone to pluralize this word for me. What do I need to add to the end of it to make it plural? All right? So if you have the answer, raise your hand and I will call on you. All right, Patricia, go ahead.
So you're gonna, in order to do that, you have to put that little, what's that called? I don't have my, hold on, let me look.
Okay.
You do the little bob. Yeah, the whole bob and the, so I'm trying to translate it from handwriting to the little...
Okay. So you're saying that I need to add the holom vav first, and why isn't it giving me that color? Give me 1 second.
And the...
So I have to add the holom vav after the resh, right?
Yes.
Okay. And then what do I need to add, or is that it?
Is it the tall? Like the...
Very... I'm sorry, say that again.
Isn't it the tav, but without the dagesh thing? So
okay, maybe... So you're telling me, Patricia, based on what I taught you or your understanding of what I taught you, all I need is a holom vav and a tav without the dagesh in it.
Yeah.
Is that your final answer?
Well, yeah, because it doesn't, you can't have a plaktek k in there. I mean, not that it's there, but you can't have.
Good, very good. So I'll just ask one more time, Miss Patricia, is this your final answer?
My final answer.
And you're correct. Very good. Nicely done. That's exactly right. So because of the fact that it's feminine, Patricia did correctly add the ending to it, which is the holom vav tav, holom vav tav. And so the way that we pronounce this word with the ending is boroth, boroth, which means pits, like armpits and so forth. But it's not that. I'm sorry. It's actually a hole in the ground. That's what that is. That's what this word is. It's not armpits. I think there's a Hebrew word for it, but I don't know what that is exactly. But very good. Nicely done. That's exactly right. That's exactly right. Okay. So let's continue on. And I am going to find... a word, let's see, can I, and that's not it. So I just got to do all that, don't I? Yes, I sure do. Okay, so my next word is going to start off with a gimel, okay? Okay, and this gimel has a dagesh in it, and then we have the bait. Okay, and then let me see, it does not, there's no dagesh in here. And then I'm going to add a shurek, and again, a shurek is the vav with the dot in it, with the dot in it, okay? And then finally, the last consonant is the lamed, and what I should have done is I should have added the schwa right here. Okay? So that's a vocal schwa, you guys. That is a vocal schwa. And the way that we pronounce this word is gavul. 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 Okay? Gavul means boundary. Boundary. Okay? This is a masculine word. All right, I want someone to give me the dual form of this masculine word. All right, and so raise your hand if you think you have it. All right, Leanne, go for it.
So do you put a patak under the lamed?
Okay.
A hirek, yod, and a final form mem.
Okay, now, is the hirek coming before the yod, or is it underneath the yod?
Hmm.
Did you hear me, Leanne? Or was did I get cut off? Leanne, can you hear me? I think her audio went off. I am going to add the final mem here. Okay. Leanne, can you hear me? Leanne, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, I can hear you now. I can hear you now. So, did you hear my question? If the yod underneath the is the hirek underneath the yod or is it before the yod? Okay, I think, unfortunately, I think my interconnection is off. If someone can confirm with me that they can hear me, can someone just raise their hand via webinar? Okay, thank you, Tony. I appreciate that. Thank you, Joseph. So I believe if I did not hear her, I believe what Leanne was going to say is that you're going to put the yod, or the hirek, excuse me, underneath the yod, okay? And so the way that we have this word is gebulayim, 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 okay? And that is correct. That is correct. This is the dual form for the word gebul, gebul, or gavul, excuse me. And so the way that we translate this word is two boundaries, okay? All right, it's about, let's see, it's 5 o'clock my time right now, and it will be, I believe, either 7 or 8 your guys' time. Why don't we take a little break? Let's take 30 minutes break, and then we'll come back, do more of these, and then we'll talk more about the conjunction Vav, okay? So let's take a 30-minute break, guys. So let's do a couple more exercises, and then we'll get into the conjunction Vav. All right, and let me erase all this. This is taking longer than I expected, so I'll do something else next time. Okay, the next word that we're going to do, we are going to do what we believe. It is wall. It is wall, and the way that we spell wall is chet. Okay, then a cholam vav. Okay. And then a mem with a comet's hey. Okay. Now, just by looking at it, you guys, let me first ask this question. What gender do you think this word is just by looking at it? And raise your hand if you have the answer. All right, Leanne, go ahead.
Is it masculine?
It's not masculine. This is default a feminine word. And here's the reason why. Here's the reason why. It's because of that comet's hey ending. Remember how I told you that that comet's hey Majority of the time, they'll let us know, or it gives us a clue that it is a feminine word. Okay, so this word is technically feminine. It is technically feminine. Okay, so it is a feminine word because of the comet's hay. All right. Yes, and so that being said, I want the dual form of this word, the dual form, okay? So if someone can tell me what the dual form of this word is, please raise your hand.
Professor?
Yes, I can hear you guys.
Okay, is it going to be a top yod spirit nymph?
I didn't hear that first part.
You got to omit the hay.
Okay, so let's start with step one. I'm going to omit the hay.
And then at the end, it's going to be a...
And then what do I have to do next?
Put I got a tav.
Okay. I'm adding a tav.
Yeah, tav, patak.
Patak, okay.
No,
okay. Yes. I'm hearing you.
Yeah. Them at the end.
And then, okay. And was there anything under the yod that I missed? I didn't hear that part.
Hirik.
A hirik. Okay, that's what I thought I heard. And then finally, a final mem.
Yes.
And is this correct, Tammy? I got everything that you said?
Yeah.
Excellent. Very good. That is right. So the dual form of this word is what Tammy... let us know and gave us. It's a tav with the patak, yod, hirek, and final mem. And so the way that we the way that we pronounce this word is tomathayim, tomathayim, okay? And the way that it's translated, it is two walls, tomathayim, okay? Excellent. Very good, you guys. Very good. So let me do one more example. And then we'll continue on. All right. The final example. What am I looking for? Let's see. All right. Here's my final example. So it begins with a mem. Okay, and underneath the mem is a hirek. Then I have a shin. Okay, and underneath the shin is a silent schwa. Okay, and then after the shin, I have a pei. All right, and I believe this pei has a dogish in it. Okay. And then and underneath the pay, we have comets. Okay. And then I got a chet with a comet. And then finally a hey. Okay. Now, so what is the gender of this word based on the way that it looks? And raise your hand if you have the answer.
Can you hear us, Professor?
Yes, and I think Tony has his hand up. So go ahead, Tony.
Professor, I was just raising my hand for Christine and to meet the other lady that has become Hebrew, the other lady's become our Hebrew arch nemesis.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. And so, Christine, go ahead then.
it feminine?
That is that is correct. It is feminine. Very good. And so what we have here is that ending kamete, which commonly lets us know that it is feminine. If it was an exception word, if it was something that's not feminine, if it was something that was masculine, I would have let you know. But based on the ending, this is a feminine word. Excellent. Very good. So that being said, the way that we pronounce this word right now, it is mishpacha. Mishpacha. That's how we pronounce it. Mishpacha. Okay? And what mishpacha means is family. Family. All right? So this is the word for family. All right? It's a feminine word, as Christine correctly pointed out. All right? I would like the plural of this word. The plural of this word. Okay? And so raise your hand if you have the answer. What's that? Oh, you didn't hear me? I'm sorry. So what I'm looking for, you guys, is the feminine plural of this word. Give me the plural form of this. And raise your hand if you feel that you have the answer. And my audio connection is going lost. Oh, dear.
I didn't hear anything you just said.
Can you guys hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry about that. I guess my internet is kind of acting funny. So basically what I'm looking for is the plural form of this word. So raise your hand if you have this. And my mega meeting's not working. So let's see. I'm going to forego North Texas. As well, I'm going to forego North Texas as well as Leanne, okay? And if anyone else wants to take a stab at it, I'm going to offer it to them. All right. Anyone else except from North Texas and or Leanne, if they want to try take a stab at this? Raise your hand if you think you got the answer. All right. I guess no one wanted to, so go ahead, Patricia.
Okay, so you're going to take away the patake.
All right, I'm going to take away the patake. That's step one, all right? So let's take away the patake, all right? What else do I need to do?
And then you need that little holam vav.
I need to add the holam vav, okay?
Whatever.
All right, and then a tav, and that's an ugly tav. A tav with a dagesh, without the dagesh in it.
That's right.
All right. So the way that we have this word is mishpachot, and that is correct. Very good. Nicely done. So okay, very cool. So that's how we basically is my brain not working today? That's how we pluralize masculine and feminine words. Okay? Any questions about that? Okay, very cool. So then let's continue on. Let's continue on and let's talk about the conjunction vav next. All right? So let's get into the conjunction vav. All right. So in when I was a kid, when I was younger, and the television was my babysitter, there was a television program on Saturday mornings known as Schoolhouse Rock, and I always remembered the song about conjunction junction, what is your function, and what is the function of a conjunction? It's basically the word and, A-N-D. It's a connecting word. So that's what the conjunction is, all right? The conjunction is the word and, okay? And just like the definite article, it's like a parasite. One more time. A lot of the words in the Hebrew language attach themselves upon other words, okay? So the conjunction does the same thing. The conjunction attaches itself upon words, okay? And so this word, the conjunction, is basically one letter, one consonant, and it's the vav with a schwa underneath it, a vocal schwa underneath it. Okay, so by default, you guys, let me write it on my pen. This here is your conjunction, and let me write it down in freehand or handwriting form. This is the word and in the Hebrew. Okay? That is the conjunction vav. Okay? And so when you attach it upon words, the most basic and simplest way to do it is just put it in front of the word. Okay? So what I have here is isha, isha. Okay? One more time. I'm going to write it down up here. I have the aleph. And then I have the shin, and I shouldn't be doing this. This is bad habit. I should write the vowels every time. So the aleph with the hirek, shin, and then there's the dagesh in here. Then we have a kametz, and then finally the hey. Okay? So isha, all right? Now the word isha, what does it mean? It's woman. It's woman, right? And so the what we have here, just this word by itself, is a woman, okay? If I wanted to add a conjunction in front of it, all I gotta do is add the vav with the schwa, okay? Okay, and so the way that we translate this word is and a woman, okay? And a woman. And so, and the way that we read the word is v'isha, v'isha. Okay, so that's the conjunction vav. That is the conjunction vav. All right. Now, just like in the definite article, there's a lot of exceptions with this vav. Okay, and that's what I'm going to go and talk about next. All right, so give me one second. Where are my notes? Okay, there you guys are. So the first, da, 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 da. The first thing that I want to talk about with this conjunction vav. Oh, yes, there's a hand up. Before I do that, I will try to answer the question. Go ahead, Tony.
I was going
Or,
to ask,
yeah, go ahead. I'm sorry.
How do you pronounce it? How do you pronounce that word again?
Yes. So the word here is v'isha. V'isha. That's how we pronounce this word with the conjunction. Okay? And Leanne, you had a question as well. Go ahead.
Is there only one conjunction in Hebrew, this one, or is there multiple?
That's a great question. I was gonna say it's just this. Yes, this is the only one. This is the only conjunction in Hebrew. So, very good question. Okay, so I'm gonna continue on. I gotta erase that. So let's continue on. And so this is the default way that the conjunction looks like, this vav with the schwa at the bottom. However, it can also be a shurek. A shurek. It could be that vowel. So there'll be a dot within the vav, right? And that's the shurek, right? It can look like that as well. It can look like that as well. And the ways that it looks like that, or when it looks like that, when I just lost my train of thought. The two ways that it'll look like that is with bump letters and words that begin with a vocal schwa, okay? So the two times, or the two reasons that the conjunction vav will look like a shurek is because of the bump letters or the words that begin with the schwa, okay? I'm going to explain more what these two mean, okay? So the first one that I'm going to talk about are the bump letters, all right? All right, so let's talk about the bump letters. The bump letters is an acronym. It's an acronym for the three consonants where the conjunction becomes a shurek, okay? And those three consonants are as follows. Yes, Leanne, go ahead. Oh, your hand was raised for 3 minutes, according to webinar. Did you have a question? I'm sorry.
Oh, I didn't have a question, sir.
Okay, all right, sorry.
I didn't.
Okay. Thank you for letting me know. I think I might have overlooked it, so I wanted to apologize for that. So these are the bump letters: bait, mem, and pay. When you see these letters begin a word, the conjunction then is a shurek. Okay, so let's do the first example. Let me write it out. Okay, this is melech, melech. And melech is the word king, right? I already told you guys that. Okay, and then one more time, just to remind you guys, this consonant is a final form kaf. It's a final form kaf with a silent schwa in it, okay? So that's why we pronounce this word as melech, melech, okay? So this is king. Now, what consonant begins this word? It's the mem, okay? The mem begins this word. Since mem is part of that family known as the bumps, B-U-M-P, bump, okay? What we do is, instead of having the vocal schwa underneath the vav, all we have is the shurek there, okay? And that will be the conjunction. That's the form of the conjunction when we have these bump letters beginning words. So the way that we pronounce this word is umelech, umelech. And that will be and a king in English, okay? Umelech, all right? That's the same thing for the second example, okay? The second example, and I'll write it underneath here. It starts with a bait, with a dagesh lene in it, a patach underneath that, a yod, with a hirek underneath it, and then finally a tav at the end, okay? And the way that this word is pronounced is bayith. And bayith means house, okay? House. We see this word in another form more often than this form. It's beth or beth, beth. And so this is where we get the word beth lachem from. Bethlehem means house of bread or house of food. Bethlehem, okay? And so what we have here is bayith. That's one form of it, okay? Again, what consonant begins this word? It is a bait. It's part of the bump letter family, those three consonants. Bait, mem, pe, okay? If that is the case, because it begins with that consonant, instead of the vav with the schwa underneath it, we have the shurek. Okay? So the way that we pronounce this is ubayith. Ubayith. Okay? Which is and a house. And a house. Okay? Questions about that? So what's the rule? What's the rule? If a word begins with a bait, mem, or pay, you have to make it a shurek, the conjunction. Okay? It changes into a shurek. It's not a vav with a vocal schwa anymore. Okay? Cool? Yes, Tony, go ahead.
Professor?
Yes, go ahead.
Can you hear us?
Yes, I can.
Just kind of out of curiosity, do we know why it changes to a shurek because of those letters?
I don't. I personally don't. I know that there's a lot of linguists who studied that, and I'm sure there's definitely a reason for it. It's, for me, though, I'm not sure why. And it's like a totally other different textbook that's like worth $500 for me to find out. And I just don't have that money. So, yeah. So that's one of the characteristics of the conjunction vav. All right? The next example, so these are bump letters. Another time when the conjunction vav becomes a shurek is with when the word starts with a vocal schwa. Okay? So what do I mean by that? So let me just erase all these letters, okay? And let me go to the next slide. Okay? So when a word begins with a vocal schwa, like in this case, all right, and let me write it out for you guys. So what we have here is a nun, and that nun underneath it is a vocal schwa, okay? Then the next letter is an ayin, okay? And under that ayin, we have a kamitz, and then we have a resh after the ayin, and the vowel is the hirik yod, and then finally, we have the final form, mem, okay? And so the word here, the way that we pronounce this word is na'arim, na'arim, okay? And na'ar, it comes from the word na'ar, na'ar. So this is a plural form of the word, na'arim. Na'ar is young lad, young lad. That's the old 1950s word for it. It's like a scallywag or like a ragamuffin. It's basically like the picture that you need to get when you see Na'ar is like Dennis the Menace. It's a rambunctious child. It's a kid who innocently gets into trouble a lot, you know? That's Na'ar. The reason why I say that is because there's a particular judge, I believe his name was Jephthah, and he's considered a Na'ar. He was like, he's the illegitimate child of someone, and he was always getting into trouble, and he was a Na'ar. Another Na'ar was David. David was a Na'ar. He was apparently always getting into trouble for some reason. So that's what this word means. It's a young man. It's a young boy. It's a lad. Or like I said, it's like a Dennis the Menace kind of child, all right? But the form of this, the plural form of this word begins with a vocal schwa, okay? In this situation, the conjunction vav does not have the schwa anymore, but it has the shurek, okay? So it will look like this with the conjunction. So the way that we pronounce this word is una'arim, una'arim, okay? And this means and young lads or and young men or something like that, okay? So that's the other difference here, okay? Okay, so the vav conjunction, will have, by default, it will have a, by default, it will have the vocal schwa underneath it, but sometimes it'll be a shereck. And the reasons why it'll be shereck is because if a word begins with a bump letter or if it begins with a vocal schwa, okay? Any questions about that? Yes, go ahead, Tony.
How would you pronounce it again with the
with the conjunction?
Yes.
U na'arim.
Thank you.
You're quite welcome. All right. Anyone else have a question? Okay, the other thing that I want to mention with the conjunction vav is when a word begins with a yod and a vocal schwa, okay? So that's the next one that I want to talk about. So I'm going to erase all this. So when a word begins with a yod and a vocal schwa, okay? And so the example that I have here is, let me write it out in handwriting form, okay? So we have a yod and then a vocal schwa, okay? Then after the yod, the next consonant is a hey. Hey, you guys, you know, hey, okay? And then the vowel with the hey is a shereck, okay? That's the vowel for the hey. And then we have the dalet. Okay, and then underneath the dalet is a comet, hey, all right? Now, the way that we pronounce this word is as follows. Yahuda, okay? I broke it down into syllables. Yahuda, okay? And so all together now, it's Yahuda, Yahuda. And this is the word that we get for Judah, Judah, okay? So this is a proper name, but this word begins with a yod and a vocal schwa, Yehuda, all right? Because of the fact that it begins with this word, the conjunction vav, what happens to that schwa, it goes away and it becomes, and it is replaced with the hirek, okay? So whenever you have a yod and a vocal schwa beginning a word, the conjunction will be the vav with the hirek, okay? And so the way that we pronounce this word is vi Yehuda, okay? So it's and Judah, all right? That's how we would translate it, but the way that we would pronounce it is vi Yehuda. Okay, so this exception only occurs when you have a yod and a vocal schwa beginning a word. That's the only time that it occurs, okay? The vav, the conjunction vav, the schwa underneath it will be taken away and it will be replaced by a hirek. All right? Questions? Okay, cool. One final thing with the vocal schwa, all right? And then I'll be done teaching stuff for you guys today, all right? We'll just go through some examples to really enforce this understanding, and then I'll talk to you guys about the homework and whatnot, and then we'll just dismiss class early, all right? The next one that I want to talk about is the conjunction vav with reduced vowels, okay? So erase. And then let's talk about reduced vowels. Remember what reduced vowels were? They were the hatef vowels. So it had a schwa with a vowel with it. Okay, that's what the reduced vowels were. All right. And so in this particular example, What we have here on the bottom of the Aleph is a Hatef Patach. Hatef Patach. That is a reduced vowel. That is a reduced vowel. All right? Here's what happens with the conjunction when you have a reduced vowel. But let me write it out. Okay? So we have the Aleph. Okay? And underneath the Aleph is the reduced vowel. The Patach with the Shwa. Okay? Or Hatef Shwa. Or, excuse me, Hatef Patach. Okay? And then after that is a Nun. Okay? And then underneath the Nun is a Kamet. All right? Then we have a Shin. Okay? And then for the vowel for the Shin is the Hirek Yod. Okay? And then we the final consonant is a final form Mem. Okay? So to read this word is Anashim. Anashim. Okay? Anashim. Anashim is the plural word for Ish. So this is men. M-E-N, men. So Anashim is the Hebrew word for men. Okay? So what happens when you have a reduced vowel and the conjunction? Okay? What you do with the vav for the conjunction is whatever the vowel is with the reduced vowel, the vav takes it. Okay? So in this example, the hatef patach, that vowel is what? It is a patach. Therefore, the vav takes that vowel. Okay? So whatever that vowel is within the reduced vowel, the conjunction vav takes that vowel. Okay? And so here, the way that we pronounce it is va'anashim. Va'anashim, which means and men. And men. Okay? Yes, someone has a question. Go ahead. Patricia, go ahead.
I just wanted to say now I'm officially lost.
I'm sorry? I didn't hear that.
Over time. I said I'm officially lost, so
okay.
Can you maybe explain it a different way?
Okay. So let me see. So let's start off from here. This particular vowel underneath the Aleph, that is known as a hatef vowel, but in English it is a reduced vowel. That's what it's called in English, a reduced vowel. Okay? And there's three. I'm gonna put the Aleph here as our example consonant. Okay? There's three of them though. There's the patach Aleph, or excuse me, it is the this is a reduced vowel and is known as the hatef patach. The hatef patach. So that's one of the reduced vowels. Another reduced vowel is the segol hatef, or the hatef segol. So you have the segol with the schwa. Okay? And then the final one is the Kamet Hatuf. The Kamet Hatuf with the Schwa. Okay, so those are the reduced vowels. And basically what a reduced vowel is, it's a vowel that has the Schwa next to it. That's what a reduced vowel is. So whenever you see a vowel and this thing next to it, that is a reduced vowel. Okay? So what happens, or the behavior of the conjunction with a reduced vowel like this, when it begins a word, whatever the vowel, the reduced vowel has, like, so in this example is the patak, the conjunction replaces that schwa with that vowel. Okay? So this one is a patak. The conjunction takes it. That's what happens. It says, oh, I'm kind of jealous. I want that patak from you. And so he the conjunction takes its own patak. All right? Let me do another example, another word. Let's do Elohim, okay? So we have Aleph. Here, we have the Segol Hatef. So it's the three dots and then the schwa, right? Lamed, Holam, Hey, Hirik Yod, Mem. Okay? So I want to add a conjunction in front of this word. Okay? So we got to add the Vav here. Basically, the Vav is kind of jealous that this Aleph has this reduced vowel. It's like, hey, that's a nice looking vowel you got underneath there. I kind of want it. And so what happens is the Vav takes whatever that vowel is, and in this case it is the Segol, and it replaces the Schwa with it. Okay? So that's what happens when you have a reduced vowel. That begins a word, and then you have the conjunction next to it. Did that help?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. All right, any other questions? Okay, so what I'm going to do then is we're going to do some more examples together. All right, so erase all drawings, take a pause for a minute. I'm going to escape this. All right. Okay, so so we did masculine and feminine nouns, plural, dual, and all that. So let's actually do some definite articles and then also the conjunction vav. Okay? So let's see. So let's do definite articles first. So I'm going to give you an example right now. All right? And it's a three-letter word. And it starts off with a somic. Okay, and underneath the somic is, I believe it's Sere. Let me see. Yes, and I am right. And then after the somic, we have a pay. Okay, and then the pay has a segol. And then finally, we got a resh. All right, so the way that we pronounce this word is sefer. Sefer, all right? And sefer in English is book, okay? That's what it means, book. So the objective to these exercises right now is we need to correctly apply the definite article to this word, okay? We need to correctly apply the definite article to this word. So that's what we're going to attempt to do, all right? And so if someone believes that they have the answer, please raise your hand via webinar and I'll call on you. All right? All right. Tony had his hand up. So go ahead, Tony. Can everyone hear me? Are we good? Is my audio okay? Can you guys hear me? Yes, no? Oh, that's why. Okay, so I apologize for that. Why is it not? Okay, you guys can hear me now? Okay, sorry about that. So Tony had his hand up via webinar. So, was it a question, Tony?
No, I was going to try to answer. That's okay.
Okay, go for it. Go for it, sir.
So, vav with a schwa?
No, now, these aren't conjunctions. I want definite articles.
I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Never mind.
All right. No worries. So, let's do definite articles first, you guys. Okay? So, who would like to take a stab at it? I will say, though, Tony, if it was a conjunction, it would have been correct. Your answer would have been correct. So, nicely done.
I'll try it again.
Okay. All right. Go for it, Tony.
All right. Would it just be the doghouse with the hay and the patak?
Okay. So, we got the hay, and then we have the patak, or patak, and then we got the doghouse. So, did I write it correctly, Tony?
Sir.
All right. And that is correct. Very good. Nicely done. So there's no exceptions to this. It's just a regular consonant. So all we need to do is we just need to apply the regular definite article upon it. Okay? Nicely done. Very good, you guys. Very good. Okay? So let's continue on with this wonderful exploration of the Hebrew. All right? So let me give you another word. And that's not what I wanted to do. So this next word that I got is derech, derech. And derech begins with a dalet. Okay. And here it is a dagesh lene, all right? And then I got a segol underneath it. Then I got a resh, okay? And underneath that resh is a segol as well. Okay. And then I got the kaf final form. Okay. And it has a silent schwa at the end of it. Again, this is for the definite article. This is for the definite article. Oh, and by the way, derech means road or way. Road or way. Okay. That's what it means in Hebrew. Derech. All right. So, who wants to take a stab at this one?
Dalet?
Yes, that is a dalet in the beginning. All right, Patricia, go ahead.
We're doing the we're still doing definite articles, right?
That's correct. We're still doing definite articles.
Well, I mean, I really couldn't find anything, so would it still just be like the hay with the potok and the kagesh? No, it's already got the already hay.
Okay, so we have the hay and the patak.
Yeah.
So what do we do with this dagesh here?
Leave it.
What's that?
Leave it alone.
Well, technically, by looking at it, yes, we would leave it alone. But specifically, by the specifics of it, what happens is this dagesh is a dagesh lene. It's a dagesh lene. What happens is with the definite article, it replaces it and becomes a dagesh forte. So it looks the same, but technically speaking, yeah, that's a dagesh forte now.
Okay.
Okay? But that's exactly right. Very good. Nicely done. Very good. So when we add the definite article to this one, it is haderech, haderech, which is the road or the way. All right? Beautiful. Let's continue on. Okay? The next word that I want to do is this word. And so I have our first word, our first consonant is aleph. Okay? And aleph has a reduced vowel underneath it. Okay? It has a reduced vowel underneath it. Okay? And then after aleph, we have a bet. Okay? And that bet has a comet underneath it. Okay? And then we have a nun. Then we have underneath the nun, and next to it is a hirek yod. And then finally, we have the mem, final form mem. So the way that we pronounce this word is avanim, avanim, okay? And avanim is stones. So it's the plural word for stone. So stones, okay? So let's still do the definite article for this one. What do we need to put? What is the correct way to put the definite article on this word?
I know.
All right, Joseph, his hand is up. Go ahead, Joseph.
So you put a. You put a gamut hay on the front. On the front.
All right. I'm going to put a hay in the front. Okay. And then what do I do next?
The gamut. With the gamut.
Gamut. It's comet. Not gamut. It's comet. This is the vowel that you're referring to, right, Joseph?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Is that your final answer, Joseph?
Yes.
All right. Are you sure? I know we're not gambling folk here, but will you put your grade upon it?
That's all I can see.
That's all you can see? Well, then I'm glad that you trusted that all that you can see, because that is correct. Very good, sir. Nicely done. Nicely done. Now, why do we have the comets there instead of the patak? It has to do with that first letter of the word, that aleph. Remember, what is an aleph? What kind of letter is an aleph? It is a guttural word. It is a guttural, not a guttural word, excuse me. It is a guttural letter, okay? And guttural letters do not like dageshes in them. They hate it. They hate it. It's not the cool thing to do for these cool gutturals, you know what I'm saying? And so what the definite marker needs to do for this particular guttural is compensatory lengthening. So the patak lengthens and becomes a comet, okay? So Joseph, you did that very well, nicely done. And so I'm going to add light to the situation. And so very good, very good. Now, I know that I'm kind of jumping the gun here, but I want someone, if they feel that they have the answer to it, I want someone to add the conjunction upon it. And doing it correctly, okay? So what is the correct way to put the conjunction on this word? How do we do that? And raise your hand if you feel that you have the answer. Ah, Leanne. Go for it, Leanne.
Sir, would it be the Shrek that you put for the conjunction at the beginning of the word?
It will not be the Shrek this time. It will not be the Shrek. But good guess on that one. The Shrek only occurs when there's a vocal schwa beginning the word or a bump letter that begins a word. Okay. So what else could it be, though? We know that it's going to be a vav. Okay. So that is something we can definitely agree upon. But what do we do to that vav, or what do we need to add to that vav to make it correct?
Maybe add a schwa?
It won't be the schwa. It won't be the schwa. It'll be the vowel next to the schwa. Okay? Remember, this is a reduced vowel, right? And so whatever vowel that's next to the schwa, that's the vowel that the conjunction will take. So in this case, it is that patach. Okay? So boom. That's what it will take. Okay? Questions about that? All right. So then, and that's one of the reasons why I wanted to bring up this example with the conjunction, because that's how this behaves. So whenever you see a reduced vowel in front of a, in the beginning of a word, and you need to add a conjunction to it, it just takes whatever that vowel is. Okay. All right. Very good. So then let's continue on. And the next one I want to do, Let's see. What would be a good one? Ah, let's do this one. So the next word I'm going to do begins with an ayin. Okay. And underneath the ayin is a kamatz. All right. And then after the ayin, we have a resh. And the vowel for the resh is a hirek yod. Okay, and then we're going to finish it off with a mem. Okay, so the way that we, and it's a final form mem, by the way, but the way that we read this word is arim, arim, okay? And this is the plural word for city. So it's cities, cities, okay? And so arim, arim, all right? So going back to the definite article, what is the correct way to implement or place the direct article for this word? And raise your hand if you believe that you have the answer.
I have it.
Who says that? Who's the one that spoke?
Hi.
Okay, all right, go for it, Patty.
I'm pretty sure you would do a hey with a patach.
Hey with the patach?
I don't know. No, the comments I meant.
The comments.
Yeah, I just got my letter confused.
Okay.
A little cheap.
Right on. No worries. This is 50% right. This is 50% right. I'm going to keep the hey, but the vowel is different. The vowel is different. It is a different vowel. And it was one of the last things that I talked about in regards to the exceptions. Okay?
Hold on. Let me find it.
All right.
Oh, yeah. It sure does. It turns into a multiple thing.
This is really a little basketball.
The three little dots. Okay, very good. There's Inky, Blinky, and Nod. Very good. And so this is known as a segel. This is known as a segel, and that is correct. This is the proper way with this particular word. This is the proper way to write the definite article for the word. Here's the reason why. It's because of this first consonant with that particular vowel. Okay, so if you see an ayin, a hey, or a chet with a comets beginning a word, that means the definite article needs to have that segel. It needs to have that segel. Okay, so that is the proper definite article form for this word. So nicely done. Let's do the conjunction for this one. Okay, who feels that they have the conjunction for this one?
Jaime does.
All right, Jaime, go for it.
I have no idea, Professor. He's just...
He believes in you, bro.
I really do believe in you, Jaime.
All right.
Yeah, help me out, TJ.
Well, let me ask you this. What consonant do we need to add here? Let's start there. And if you don't know the name, describe it to me.
Bob.
Very good. Yeah. Excellent. And so that's right. That's right. So we're 50% there. All we need to do is we need to figure out what we need to add to the VOV to make it the correct use of the conjunction. And for me, and I can see that it's not a bump letter, nor does it begin with a vocal schwa, this word, okay? And there's no reduced vowel to this letter, all right? So for me, I just go to the default, all right? And what would the default be, Jaime?
Schwa.
Very good, sir. Nicely done. Nicely done. And that is correct. So the conjunction here is the vav with the vocal schwa underneath it. And so the way that we pronounce this word is va'arim, va'arim, okay? I should have done the one before it, but so let me pronounce this word va'arim, which is and cities in English, all right? Let me actually apply the definite article again, okay? And then here we add the seagulls, inky, blinky, and nod. And the way that we pronounce this, or the way that we read this, is he'arim, he'arim, okay? Which is the cities, all right? All right. So let's do a couple more. Let's do a couple more. So I am going to eliminate this word, all right? And then the next word that we're going to work on is the following. It starts with the mem, okay? And underneath the mem is a vocal schwa, all right? And then we have a resh after that with a patach or patach, okay? Then we have gimel. And the gimel has a dogish lene, okay? And underneath it is a silent schwa, okay? And then what else is there? Lamed, my favorite consonant. A hirek yod. And then finally, a mem, okay? So the way that we read this word, the way that we pronounce this word, is m-raglim, m-raglim, m-raglim. And what is m-raglim? It's what James Bond is. It's a spy. And so it's the plural word for spies, okay? So it's m-raglim, m-raglim. And so let's start off with the definite article. What is the proper way to write the definite article for this word? And raise your hand if you have the answer.
Professor?
Yes?
Is it a hay with a patah?
Okay, so let me start off from what I've been hearing. We have a hay, and then we have a patah, okay? Do I need to add anything else to this?
Baggage. I don't know.
Yeah, dog is.
Isn't the dog? And I don't think. Or is it just, oh, basic one? Okay. But see, this one, this is what's going on. Look at number six.
So is it just the hay and the potach?
I think it might be.
You think it might be? Is it your final answer?
We're not sure if it's a basic form or if it's just.
Okay, okay. You want to grab a lifeline, or are you just gonna? Are you gonna say this is my final answer?
According to our book, she's right.
According to the book, she's right. Oh dear.
Well, because yeah, it's got the little men with the that vocal schwa thing, or the schwa. I don't know if I'm joking or not.
Right.
On our thing under the definite article, it would take on form six, which is the basic form. It would go all the way down. It's on our thing. It just shows the hay with the
patach
in our.
Hay with the patach, huh? Let's see. What page is it?
Well, it's a little. We have the like a chart thing that we ordered with our book.
Oh, it's the chart. Okay. I will say this thing. The answer here is two thirds right. It's two thirds right. There needs to be a dogish here. Needs to be a dogish there. Okay?
How do you determine that, Professor, when you're not supposed to put it in the dog?
Okay, the only reason why it will never ever be there for the definite article is if that word began with a guttural. Okay? So it's either the het, the hey, the aleph, or the ayin. If a word begins with any of those four, it will not have the dagesh in there. Okay. All the other consonants will have the dagesh in there.
Can we show you though what we're seeing in our on our thing?
Yes, I would love to, because I think if that is the case, that will be a fatal error on that chart.
Okay. Where is the camera? Can you see it?
I can. Yes. I see your hand.
All right. Hold on. Can you see the chart? It's going to be over here.
Yeah. Unfortunately, it's still too small. Okay. And move it more to the right.
Right.
And go bring it up more. And bring it down a little more. There we go. Okay. Number six.
Yeah, hold on. My hand's shaky.
Okay.
Had a lot of caffeine today. And I don't know.
A before? Interesting.
It?
All right. I will take a look at that. I really don't think that's true. I personally don't think that's true. So, but who am I to disagree with Practico and Van Pelt? They've been doing it for like 40 years. So let me check it out and I'll let you know, but I'm pretty sure you definitely need the dagesh in there based on the rules of how I understand it. Okay. All right. Now the last thing that we'll do, and this is for this word, the last thing we'll talk about is, let's do the conjunction here. Let's add the conjunction here. All right. What conjunction needs to be attached, or how does the conjunction need to look like for this word to make it correct? And raise your hand if you have it.
Christine has it.
All right, Santiago, go for it. So what Santiago is saying is this needs to be the conjunction in order to be correct. And are you putting all your chips in, Santiago, with that answer?
Everything.
Well, you're right then. Very good, sir. Nicely done. That's exactly right. Why do we put a shurek there? It's because this consonant is a mem, and it is a bump letter. It is a bump letter, and therefore it is a shurek. Okay? So Nicely done. You have won the proverbial prize of fake money. So very good. All right. Excellent. So what am I asking you guys to do for next week? You will have a vocabulary quiz. You will have one more vocabulary quiz. And just like the rest of them, you can take it as many times as you want. Okay? So that's one. All right? The next thing is also you will have a Bible passage. You will have a Bible passage. And the Bible passage that you are, the final Bible passage that you are going to read is something known as the Shema. Okay? So I'm not sure how many of you guys ever heard of the Shema, but it is basically the foundational doctrinal prayer for the Hebrew people. Okay? This is their theology. This is their theology. Okay? And so for this, so this is, and also the reason why I want to finish this out is because this is also the prayer that the Jewish people prayed and sang in the gas chambers in Nazi Germany. All right. Wow. Yeah. And so this, so when the Nazi soldiers were burning them alive and gas chambers and stuff, you will hear the old rabbi or the old Jewish men and the old and the children recite this prayer in the gas chambers. So it's a very powerful, powerful prayer. Okay. And it is known as the Shema. And it comes from Deuteronomy 6, 4, and 5. Deuteronomy 6, 4, and 5. And yes, Santiago, you have your hand up. Go ahead.
Never mind.
Oh, okay. And so this is what it is, and I'll give it to you guys either today, either tomorrow or Thursday, okay? But let me read it. Let me read it to you guys, and just again, it still gives me goosebumps when I read it. You know, it's that powerful. So what it is as follows. And it reads as so: Shema Yisrael, Hashem Eloheinu, Hashem Echad. Va'achavta et Hashem Elohecha, va'chol lavavka, uva'chol nafeshka, uva'chol ma'odecha. Okay? And so what it is in English is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And that is the Shema. Okay? And so that's what I want us to finish out with for our class, okay? So I want you guys to read that and give me the passage upload for next week, okay? I will also get you guys a Greek worksheet, okay, for your word study. So just like you did for Hebrew, please do it for Greek, okay? And also, there's a homework, a Hebrew homework worksheet that I have for you guys. And give me one, where's my mouse? Where are you? What? Okay. Sorry. Okay. So here's the homework. Here's the Hebrew homework, which I will get you guys out either tomorrow or Thursday. Okay. Okay. So it's just five. Actually, it's technically nine. I want you guys to know, do not do number four. Okay. So don't do this one. All right. But basically, it's just doing what we've done so far. I want you to pluralize those words, and then I want you to give the definite article on these words. Okay. That's all I'm looking for. All right. So that's it. That's it for next, for the week following. And then we'll talk about the last thing in week 10, and then we'll go into your final, and that'll be it for spring semester. Okay. Any questions? Yes.
Do you record the vocabulary and the